morning, St. Matthew. Good morning on this Sunday, the first Sunday after Easter. It is still time for celebration. So he is risen.
He is risen indeed.
He has risen.
He's risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Let us start with our first song and let's sing This Is Amazing Grace.
Breaks the power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty, is so much stronger. The King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole world with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless and all in wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Our chaos back into order, who makes the orphan a son and daughter. The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Oh, this is amazing grace, this is unfailing love, take my place, then you would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. I sing for all that you've done for me. All that you've done for me. Yeah.
Well, good morning to St. Matthew and the second Sunday of Easter. We are glad to have you with us. And we thank you for all the blessings that you've sent into us. And we ask that you continue to bring food for our food pantry, or you can send some money in and we'll go out and buy the food. Or if you can help shop for us for the food pantry, please let us know. The doors to the gym are open from 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. each day for you to bring food in. We do have a lot of families who are taking advantage of the food pantry at this time. Also, we have the garden plots, and if you would like to get outside and do some work in the dirt, this is the time to do it, time to be turning that dirt over, time to be planting those seeds, so take advantage of that as well. Many of you joined us last Sunday for that drive-in service. That was amazing. We got many good responses, and what we decided to do is to do it just every so often. So we plan to do that either the first or the second week of May based on weather, and we'll be letting you know all about that, and we hope to see you there in a socially responsible way and enjoy that time of getting together again. Well, let's start our service, Vicar Dave.
We make our beginning in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Alleluia, for we know that since Christ was raised from the dead, he cannot die again.
Death no longer has dominion over him. Alleluia.
Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed.
Alleluia, alleluia.
Lord, you poured out blessings on your land.
You restored the fortunes of Israel.
You forgave the iniquity of your people.
You covered all their sin.
Show us your unfailing love, O Lord.
And grant us your salvation.
Let us then confess our sins unto our gracious Lord. Almighty God,
in humility and with repentant hearts, we come before you seeking your forgiveness. We have not lived up to our calling to shine your light of goodness and grace and to live in peace with others. We sincerely repent of our sins in thought, word, and deed. Have mercy on us, merciful Father, for the sake of Jesus Christ, your Son. Forgive us with your compassionate grace, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, direct us to serve you faithfully all of our days.
God has promised his merciful forgiveness to those who repent of their sins and turn to him. He will revive them and speak peace to his people. Your sins have been paid for by Christ. They are forgiven. May God keep you in his grace and lead you in ways of peace and joy until the day we live with him forever. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Alleluia. Christ is risen.
He's risen indeed. Alleluia.
May the peace of the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
The cross has the final word. The cross has the final word. And sorrow may come in the darkest night, but the cross has the final word. There's nothing stronger, nothing higher, nothing greater than the name of Jesus. All the honor and all the power, all the glory to the name of Jesus. The cross has the final word. The cross has its strongest fight, but the cross has the final word. There's nothing stronger, nothing higher, nothing greater than the name of Jesus. And all the honor, all the power, all the glory to the name of Jesus. The cross has the final word. The cross has the final word. The Savior has come with the morning light, but the cross has the final word. cross has the final word. The cross has the final word. He traded death for eternal life, but the cross has the final word. The Savior has come in the morning light, but the cross has the final word.
Let us pray. Almighty God, as we struggle with the doubts, fears, and uncertainties that we daily face in our lives, help us to remember your faithfulness and the promise and hope of our Lord's resurrection. By your grace, grant that we continue to share the faith and hope we have in Jesus, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
We now hear from our first reading. Our first reading is from the book of Acts, chapter 5, verses 29 to 42. Peter and the other apostles replied, "We must obey God, not human authority. You killed Jesus by nailing him to a cross. But the God our ancestors worshiped raised him to life and made him our leader and savior. Then God gave him a place at his right side so that the people of Israel would turn back to him and be forgiven. We are witnesses of these things, and so is the Holy Spirit, who is God's gift to everyone who obeys God." When the leaders heard this, they became angry and wanted to kill them. But a Pharisee named Gamaliel stood up in the meeting. He was a teacher of the law, and all the people respected him. He ordered the apostles to leave the meeting for a little while. And then he said, "People of Israel, be careful what you are planning to do to these men. Remember when Theudas appeared? He said he was a great man, and about 400 men joined him. But he was killed, and all his followers were scattered. They were able to do nothing. Later, a man named Judas came from Galilee at the time of the registration. He also led a group of followers and was killed, and all his followers were scattered. And so now I tell you, stay away from these men. Leave them alone. If their plan comes from human authority, it will fail. But if it is from God, you will not be able to stop them. You might even be fighting against God himself." The leaders agreed with what Gamaliel said. They called the apostles in, beat them, and told them not to speak in the name of Jesus again. Then they let them go free. The apostles left the meeting full of joy because they were given the honor of suffering disgrace for Jesus. Every day in the temple and in people's homes, they continued teaching the people and telling the good news that Jesus is the Christ. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our second promise comes from 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 to 9. "Praise God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is merciful, and by raising Jesus from death, he has given us new life and a hope that lives on. God has something stored up for you in heaven, where it will never decay or be ruined or disappear. You have faith in God, whose power will protect you until the last day. Then he will save you, just as he has always planned to do. On that day, you will be glad, even if you have to go through many hard trials for a while. Your faith will be like gold that has been tested in a fire. And these trials will prove that your faith is worth much more than gold that can be destroyed. They will show you that you will be given praise and honor and glory when Jesus Christ returns. You have never seen Jesus, and you don't see him now, but still, you love him and have faith in him, and no words can tell how glad and happy you are to be saved. That's why you have faith. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
All the money that the world could hold, mountains made of solid gold, riches that could buy my dream, you are better than all these things. The prettiest face to turn their eyes, beauty that could hypnotize, open doors that looks may bring, you are better than all these things. Your love is better than life. You are the well that won't run dry. I have tasted and I have seen. You are better than all these things. Power that can shake the moon. Most important one in every room. Status matched by only kings. You are better than all these things. Your love is better than life. You are the well that won't run dry. I have tasted and I have seen. You are better than all these things. 'Cause your love is better than life. You are the well that won't run dry. I have tasted and I have seen. You are better than all these things. Being liked and loved by everyone. Approval that outshines the sun. Cheered by all who think of me. You are better than all these things. You are better than all these things. You're better. Oh, you're better. I have tasted and I have seen. You are better than all these things. You are better than all these things. You are better than all these things. I know you are better than all these things. These things, oh, I know you are better than all these things. Jesus, I know you are better than all these things.
The Holy Gospel according to John, the 20th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together, with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he had said this, he showed them his hand and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, they are forgiven. And if you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." Now Thomas, also called Didymus, was one of the 12, who was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my fingers where the nails were and put my hand into the side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and have faith." Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said, "Thomas, do you have faith because you have seen me? The people who have faith in me without seeing me are the ones who are really blessed." Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written so that you will put your faith in Jesus as the Messiah and the Son of God. If you have faith in him, you will have true life. This is the gospel of the Lord. We confess our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man, who was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the scriptures and ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he shall come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshiped and glorified, and who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian church and apostolic. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Make my beginning in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. He is risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
As I said earlier, this is the second Sunday of celebrating Easter. You know, Easter is this time to be happy. We have all these things going on in spring. Things are springing up. Grass is needing to be cut. Kids are out playing. Flowers are blooming. We've got all kinds of events happening. People are looking forward to the prom and graduation and Mother's Day and spring weddings. Well, maybe not. Not this year. This year, things are very different. You know, it's kind of like that first year, that first Easter, that even though, as we heard last week, that the disciples had seen the empty tomb, and then Mary had said that she saw Jesus, they still were full of fear. They still didn't get it completely and understand what all that meant. And so they were afraid, and they had their doors locked. They were living in fear of the Jews and the Romans. Everybody knew that they were followers of Jesus, and so they were being isolated. They were making sure that others weren't around them. Maybe you have a little of that going on today also with this COVID-19 things. Things are different. And so there they are in the midst of their fears. They had these hopes for the future. They believed that they had this amazing future coming with Jesus Christ, this freeing Israel. And all those hopes and dreams were sealed in the tomb, and that even though Christ had risen, those hopes and dreams hadn't come to them yet. And all of a sudden, Christ appears. Out of nowhere, he's there in the midst of them, and he says those words, "Peace be with you." Those special words that we all need to hear in the midst of our fears, "Peace be with you." And so he shows them his hands and his side, and they rejoice. They know that it's him. They're amazed with this amazing revelation of Jesus being there. Their faith is getting rebuilt. And as I said last week, we've got that saying that faith and hope, they go together. And so with faith, you have this deeper understanding of the resurrection. There is more hope. You will have a secure future because hope, faith is the foundation of our hope. We have this amazing hope as we look more and more deeply into this resurrection of Jesus Christ, understanding who Jesus was and what went on. Now, as we heard in the gospel, Thomas wasn't there. Thomas maybe dealt with things differently than the rest of the disciples. Maybe he had a different temperament, a different personality. But Thomas maybe wanted to deal with things alone because he was hurt. He was deeply hurt. Jesus was who he was following. He believed that Jesus was the Messiah, that Jesus was going to save Israel. And then all of a sudden he lost. The Romans captured him, beat him, nailed him to a cross. His lifeless body was laid in the tomb. Everyone knew that he had lost. And so what could it be? Even though he had heard the rumors of the empty tomb and Mary's testimony about seeing Jesus, he still had too much hurt in his heart. His heart had been broken by that happening, and how could he so easily believe? So even though now the disciples come to him and say, "We've seen the Lord," not just two of them, but the whole group of them saying we had seen the Lord, he still couldn't believe it that easily. He had been deeply hurt. Maybe you've been hurt by people that you love or you'd put your hopes in. You know, it happens to pretty much all of us at some point in our lives, different things that hurt us. Maybe a spouse, you know, and people that have alcoholism or drug addiction, quite often their spouses say, "I can't trust you anymore." They've been hurt so much that it takes years to repair that hurt and to build that trust again. And so even though these friends of Thomas's are telling them that they've seen the Lord, he can't believe. And so he even says, you know, "Unless I see the nail marks and put my finger into them, and I see the hole in his side and put my hand into it, I can't believe." You know, Thomas has that pain that he suffered. Maybe during all this COVID-19, you're experiencing some pain and loss of trust and how and who God is. You know, Thomas believed that Jesus was God. He believed that God was all-powerful, that God was good, but yet how could he allow Jesus to be killed? How could that possibly have happened? And there's that classic Christian question. If God is all-powerful and God is good, how in the world can he allow suffering? Thomas was suffering from this hurt from Jesus. Maybe you've had that classic question. How can that be possible? You know, in the midst of this COVID-19, maybe you're wondering what happened to the prom or what happened to graduation. Maybe you've lost a job or even lost a business. Can you imagine the hurt and the pain? And how would God let that happen? How can God even let your loved ones get sick and even die? How can that be in the midst of all of this? An all-powerful God, a good God, allow that to happen. And so Thomas is questioning. In fact, he's doubting. But there's a difference between being a doubter and being an unbeliever. You see, someone that doubts is questioning. He's being skeptical and he wants to understand who God is and what the power of God is and what the love of God is and what a godly life is. But someone who's an unbeliever, they don't even really think about God. They're apathetic. They kind of blow off the whole topic. They're actually very self-centered, in their thoughts and what they need and want. A doubter, on the other hand, may ask 1,000 questions. He may explore what the love of God really is. Thomas wanted to understand the divinity of God, and what he had seen happen to Jesus was totally not possible if God was all-powerful. He didn't get it. And so he's doubting, and he wants to look at the evidence and try to understand. In fact, he even wants to look at it from an intellectual point of view and try to prove that. But in the midst of all of that hurt and all of that pain, an amazing thing happens. For we hear that a week later, Thomas is there with the other followers, again, behind closed doors. And in the midst of them, Jesus does appear. And Thomas sees those marks. Jesus even says, "Put your fingers in the hole and put your hand into the side." And he says, "Thomas, stop unbelieving and believe." And then he says something for us. He says, "Blessed are those who haven't seen yet believe." Now, we don't believe on our own. We believe because of the gifts of God, the gifts that God's given us, the gift of his Holy Spirit. For you remember on that first timing when he met with the disciples and Thomas wasn't there, he breathed on the disciples and they received that gift of the Holy Spirit. And so the disciples, including Thomas, all change. They go from hiding in fear behind locked doors to announcing about who Christ was. That's what we had in that first reading from Acts. We had them talking about who Jesus is and about how he's the Savior. They were no longer afraid. They were filled with hope because faith goes together with hope, and it builds this hope for the future. We've got an amazing hope in the future. We've got this gift of the Holy Spirit that gives us faith, that then gives us hope, that we know that we are God's children, that we know that we have eternal life, and we are loved by God, and it opens up a whole new future. Maybe in the midst of this pain from COVID-19, this time of separation when you're wondering about losses and all that, explore deeper the death on the cross, the resurrection. Have your faith, because the more you question, the deeper your faith will become. The more that you look into what Christ has will give you an amazing blessing, a deeper and stronger faith by looking into that. All Christians have doubts and have questions. Mother Teresa, when they published her diaries, it showed the number of times that she questioned who God was and how could these things be happening to these people she cared for. But yet her faith grew deeper and deeper as she did those questions. You too can have your faith grow deeper and deeper. And so after Thomas saw Jesus, he said, "My Lord and my God." He made that amazing announcement. You know, when John wrote this book about Jesus, he was very particular in how he joined it all together. And going all the way back to the very beginning of the book, John said, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." So John is announcing even then, and he brings it all the way to the close here with Thomas announcing, "My Lord and my God." And then those next verses that we have in 30 and 31, "Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book, but these are written so that you will have faith in Jesus as the Messiah, as the Son of God. And if you have faith in him, you will have true life." You have that amazing gift from God of the Holy Spirit that gives us faith, and that faith gives us a certain hope, a firm foundation in the future. Take time to read that book that John wrote this week. Take time to look at this book, The God Questions, that we passed out last weekend. If you didn't get one, come by the church, and at the entrance of the sanctuary, we'll have some in a box for you to grab. Use it for yourself or use it for friends who are having questions about God and need to get deeper into an understanding and into their faith. God has blessed you, and he has firmly arisen. Now may that peace that passes all understanding keep your hearts and your minds on our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus, and for all people according to their needs. that the peace of God would dwell upon the church and those we serve. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer and grant us peace.
We pray for the nations of the world and their leaders, that those in authority would lead with wisdom, patience, and humility as they seek peace and tranquility in our time. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer and grant us your peace.
We pray for the health, safety, and well-being of our congregation and the community in which we serve. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer and grant us your peace.
We pray for the protection, both physical and emotional, of those who serve and protect our communities, state and nation, including our police, fire, healthcare servants, and armed forces. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer and grant us your peace.
That those facing trials and challenges and difficulties, including the unemployed, those who mourn, those dealing with fear or depression, would trust in your abiding presence and peace. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer and grant us your peace.
We pray for healing and comfort for those who are sick. We especially lift up those suffering from COVID-19, mental illness, and diseases. Grant their doctors wisdom, guidance, and compassion during their care and recovery. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer and grant us your peace.
For these things and all else that we hold in our hearts, we ask as we celebrate the resurrection and in the name of our risen Savior, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
We pray as the Lord taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
We'd like to thank you for all the generous offerings that you have given, and we encourage you to keep your offerings coming to the church, either by dropping them off here or by sending them in electronically. And now, Pastor Blaise, next steps.
Next steps to believe in the resurrection, examine the evidence, read John's testimony, that book that John wrote, and take time to read the God questions. And share this book with others, share that information with others.
And now, receive the benediction. The Lord bless you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace.
Amen.
resurrection somehow. And now I'm lost in your freedom. And this world, how overcome. My God's not dead, he's surely alive. He's living on the inside, roaring like a lion. God's not dead, he's surely alive. He's living on the inside, roaring like a lion. God's not dead, he's surely alive. He's living on the inside, roaring like a lion. God's not dead, he's surely alive. He's living on the inside, roaring like a lion. Let heaven roar and fire fall on, and shake the ground with the sound of revival. Let heaven roar and fire fall on, and shake the ground with the sound of revival.
Go in peace. Serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
God's not dead. He's surely alive. He's living on the inside, roaring like a lion. God's not dead. He's surely alive. He's living on the inside, roaring like a lion. God's not dead. He's surely alive. He's living on the inside, roaring like a lion. God's not dead. He's surely alive. Roaring like a lion.